insurance-wise, we have, so one of the things we must analyze whenever we deal. So if you are the freight forwarder, if you are the indirect air carrier, if you are a logistics provider, and you probably do operate your own fleet of trucks, or if not, your independent contractors do. Well, usually you are required to have some kind of liability insurance, and then the question is, if something happened, like let's say there was a damage of goods, so you deal with an insurance company who comes to you because it's a subrogee, meaning that it stepped into the shoes of the party that lost the stuff. But you also have your own liability insurance, mostly associated with the truck. And it's very important to really look at the details of the insurance terms and conditions, or the contractual provisions itself, because sometimes they may be found contradictory. And when for example, let's say it may be easier for you to take care of things through the insurance company rather than to make an argument, make a Montreal Convention argument. And in this case, if you are, you are required to look at the terms and provisions, and they are not perfect. Even though we are used to see that the insurance companies, they perfected their provisions to the dot, nevertheless, you still have situations where you have a complicated insurance contract, and one paragraph can contradict another. Without naming an insurance company, let me just give you an example which I dealt with in my world as an attorney, not as an educator. So you have one paragraph. So basically, the background is this. So you have the tractor trailer driver who was taking the container from the container yard and delivering it to the local warehouse. In the local warehouse, you have the situation where the local warehouse either worked by appointment or it couldn't accept the delivery soon. So the trucker was waiting in line. And during that wait, things turned sour, and the whatever was within the container, it went bad. So the question is it covered by the insurance or not? So one provision of the insurance excludes the properties. It's the same agreement. It talks about storage, which says any property on the insured after on the insured auto after it has remained at any locations for more than 72 hours is excluded. So the insurance company goes in and says, okay, this is excluded property, so we are not covering that. But the other provision on a rider, it had a in due course of transit provision, which said the opposite. Any, for example, it in due course of transit includes from point A to point B upon the first of the whichever first of following occurs, and as a D, it includes any other stop it which exceeds 72 hours. Right. So you have a provision which says if it's more than 72 hours, it's excluded. But then if the other provision that says more than 72 hours is included because it's in due course of transit. So you have one which is so. And the next question: what's in due course of transit? If the warehouse cannot accept the stuff, cannot wait. I mean, you have to wait. Is it in due course of transit? So then you have due course of transit argument. Of course, that definition is not very well provided. But the point of this example is that insurance contracts themselves, they are not perfect by themselves, and mostly they are not. They have, most of them have good intentions, but because many of them span across multiple pages of documents, they are really become so complicated that it becomes very difficult to follow. So, and once it becomes very difficult to follow, you may have conflicting provisions where one contradicts another. So that's why you have those you have those paragraphs which say the depending on the situation can say the opposite things.